Welcome into Laker Connections tonight. Beside me, as always, Ben Grieco. Ben, how you doing? Lightning loss tonight?
I don't want to talk about it. This shirt's supposed to be bringing up my spirits right now. It's not going well.
Well, either way, you look like a highlighter, but let's get into it. Some golf action here. The Oswego State golf team went to the Hershey Country Club to participate in the spring tournament for the Empire 8. While the Lakers were in first heading into the tournament, St. John Fisher took both the third and fourth rounds. The Lakers shot a 316 for the third round and a 310 for the fourth. Oswego State finished in second place, 16 strokes behind St. John Fisher. Sean Paul Owen, however, earned individual medalist honor, shooting a 292 over the course of the entire tournament. Owen shot a 72 in the first round, a 73 in the second, a 77 in the third, and a 70 to round out the fourth round. His 292 was the second lowest in tournament history and also garnered him Player of the Year honors for the Empire 8.
And now moving over to the Laker Turf Stadium, the Oswego State men's lacrosse team took on SUNY Potsdam in a midweek SUNYAC matchup. Here it is, 1-1 tie game. Tim Schaaf of Oswego State trips up himself, but gets inside after a spin move and gets inside, scores two, and now it's 2-1. Lakers now 12 minutes left in the second quarter. Josh Huiat from SUNY Potsdam gets it to Gabe Carbone on the man up. Carbone with an absolute snipe past Kevin O'Donnell. SUNY Potsdam only trails by one, and now Oswego State again. Schaaf again. Now on the outside, gives it to 6'1" Weston Gray right in front, who throws it down for the two-goal lead. And Oswego State now in the third quarter, leading 8-5. Schaaf once again runs in for mid-length shot. 9-5 Lakers. And jumping to the final regulation corner, SUNY Potsdam's Josh Bradford from way outside with another laser past O'Donnell. Bears only trailing by one. Now a little tic-tac-toe for the Lakers. Schaaf to Evan Holfeller to the middle for Bobby Eberson, who gets the Lakers' 11th goal of the game. SUNY Potsdam would get one back, but 11-9 would be the final in favor of the Lakers.
And following that win over SUNY Potsdam, Oswego State tried to roll that momentum into its weekend matchup against Plattsburgh State at home, a team the Lakers have not beaten since 2009. So let's kick it to the turf here at Oswego State. Starting early, man up, Eric Keel buries this one, his second of the season, off the feed from Bobby Emerson. But then James Sherwood, he's going to score and gallop through that one to tie it at two with 8:35 left in the first quarter. And again, Oswego State, Evan Holfelder, head fake, rips that one from deep to make it 3-2, his 12th of the season. We had a scoreless second quarter, but then Dan Doolin off a power move, a nice finish up top. That finds Twine, it's 4-2, Oswego State leads. And then Dan Doolin again, some separation. That one's in the back of the cage to make it 5-4. Bobby Emerson would make it 6-4, and this is where the drama gets good. Plattsburgh, Jack Mullen scores his third of the game to make it 6-5. And then in and out of the stick, Jack Mullen to Jake Carroll ties it at 6. And then in double overtime, looks like it went in, but no. That one is going to be called back, a crease violation. And the Lakers live for just a little bit longer. But it's Jake Carroll, scoops up the ground ball, finishes a great celebration, and Oswego State could not snap that losing streak. It's now at 10 games, and the Lakers drop this one, a pivotal SUNYAC matchup to the Plattsburgh State Cardinals.
Now, while my shirt may be bright, over to the women's lacrosse team, who didn't have such a bright game against SUNY Geneseo to take on the Red Hot Knights in another SUNYAC matchup. Early on, SUNY Geneseo was on an early run, four straight goals. Hannah Marafiotti runs all the way in from midfield after a turnover. She gets the Knights' fifth straight goal past Eliana Sanchez. Now Marafiotti again. Get used to that name. In the circle, left wide open, throws the ball at the bottom of the net, and now it's 6-0 in favor of the Knights. Moving into the second half, Lakers trail by two. Teresa Shattuck gets a lob over to the net to Cameron Sherman right in front. Oswego State only trails by one. Oswego State again here. Bridget Regan outside gives it to Molly Beck in front. Oswego State now tying it up at 8 with 17:45 left. And now Oswego State trailing once again. Montana Garrett gets a pass from the outside, runs inside, and throws a shot from her hip and ties it up once again. Now 10 goals apiece. Crunch time, 4:53 left. Tessa Duty gets a lob pass from Marafiotti. Duty spins and gets a shot right over Sanchez. And now the Knights lead 11-10. 12-10, free possession for SUNY Geneseo. 1:40 left in the game. Marafiotti goes low past Eliana Sanchez. Marafiotti with her fifth of the game. Oswego State would get one back eventually, but the falls to the Knights, 13-11.
And that same Laker team made the trek up to Plattsburgh for an away conference matchup as they try to avoid a mini two-game skid. And we are on Teresa Shattuck watch here in Plattsburgh. Starting things off, Tony Leneve, a give and go with Shattuck. Right back to her. She got lost. And Oswego State up 3-1 at the 26-minute mark. Then Riley Jaquin turns on the burners here. That's an easy finish all day. Oswego State up 6-2, but they keep piling it on here. Bridget Regan, watch this move. Separation, nice spin move, and she's got all day, buries that one down low in the corner to make it 13-2, her 27th of the year. And finally, still on Shattuck watch here in Plattsburgh. It's a 19-2 game, but this one not uneventful. And it's Riley LaCava who finishes the Shattuck feed from behind the cage. Her 7th point of the night and her 304th of her career. That ties her with the 03 graduate, Catherine Steed. And now Erin Shattuck in 3rd place, her sister, graduating in 2016, is at 235. But at least 4 games for Teresa Shattuck to break that record. And she very well could do that in the next one coming up here, Ben.
And Cole, and as you said, we're on the Shattuck watch. We're excited to see what she can do in her last regular season matchups. But in general, for this team, how important is this weekend set of Suniac games?
I think it's really important. Their offense is just starting to flourish where they are using people throughout their whole lineup to score. You know, we talked in previous shows about Shattuck's inability to really finish in close games. This one wasn't. She was able to get those points out of the way. Now she's all she's got to do is tie. It's not worried about that, but just getting this offense, a lot of different people contributing so they can see what they need to pull out of the tank come playoff times, try to get a win in that first round.
Definitely should be interesting heading into the rest of this season.
All right, coming up on the other side of the break, Ben will have our first athlete interview of the semester. Find out who will be joining us when we come back on Laker Connections on WTOP 10.
Josh, the stream's not working. We need you to fix it right now.
The stream's down? I'll be right there.
Oh my god, so you'll never believe what happened to Khloe Kardashian this week.
Oh my god, what happened? Tell me.
Okay, so she was at the mall, shopping at Saks.
Oh, hey, didn't see you there.
Hey, we're practicing for our new show, What's the Tea, starring me.
And me.
Hey, Brianna, when does it air?
Every other Sunday at 10 o'clock.
Oh yeah, I almost forgot.
Anyway, I can't wait for you to sip some tea with us.
Only on WTOP. Ooh.
Welcome back to Laker Connections. I'm here with senior Sean Paul Owen of the Oswego State golf team, who just earned Empire 8 Player of the Year honors. Thanks for joining me, Sean.
Thank you for having me.
And so, Sean, let's talk about the team real quick. Obviously, you guys finished the fall season with a couple of first place finishes. You finished second Empire 8. Where would you, I guess, rate the team right now heading into the end of the season?
We had a good showing this year. In the fall, we took second to in the Empire 8 combined, we took second to St. John Fisher. They've won, I think, the past 9 years, but we cut the margin down. I think we lost by 71 strokes last year and cut it down to maybe 15 this year. So we're improving as a team, and I'm excited to see where else we go golf has to go in the future.
And so with the only couple tournaments left, you guys missed out, unfortunately, on the automatic qualifier for the tournament, getting second in the Empire 8. Do you think, personally, there's any chance for either you individually or team-wise for you to get to the national championship, like the pool bid?
Most likely not. We pretty much needed to win our conference to get in. There's a lot of good teams out there that pl- play down south, you know, D3 that have better conditions, and they're able to get lower scoring averages than we have, so we probably won't be able to make it to the tournament.
How about you individually? Do you think you can?
I talked to my coach, most likely not. There's five spots up, so most likely not, unfortunately. But.
So, and now looking at your season, you posted a 292 at the E8, you got second lowest score in tournament history, 10 strokes off the record. How do you think the tournament went for you playing that kind of consistently?
It went well, obviously. Won the tournament, played well. The first day I shot 77, I was a little disappointed with my short game. Didn't really chip it close enough, didn't make enough putts. The second day, managed to get it lower. Reduced my putts by seven putts, and my score reduced by seven putts. So, you know, short game really helped me the second day, but overall consistency, I felt pretty good about my rounds.
And so, speaking of chipping in, you chipped in on the 18th on your last day to kind of just, you know, that final push. What was that kind of emotion like, knowing that you had the tournament, you chipped in on that final hole when everyone kind of there? What was that kind of like emotion like?
Yeah, it was nice. It was funny because the kid I was playing with, Jake, who got freshman of the year this year from Nazareth, we both had similar chips, and right before we went, he's like, let's knock these in. And we were kind of laughing about it, and he chipped and just missed his, and I chipped in, so we kind of had a little laugh about that, so it was fun.
Always the fun thing about golf, personally, is getting to talk with the other guys, maybe a little more friendship. But now, being named Player of the Year, individual medalist for the team, obviously you prefer all those team accolades, maybe getting the Nationals, winning the E8, but what do those individual accolades mean to you, kind of wrapping up your collegiate career?
You know, it's nice to be recognized, but it's a team sport. You know, the real goal this year was to win Empire 8. Unfortunately, we didn't get it done. But Oswego Golf, you know, we got some good freshmen coming forward. Ryan Fico this year played really well. Joe Marzlak, who played in the CUCA tournament, played really well there. So it'll be exciting to see what we got going forward with. And also the seniors next will be Dan Mort and Eric Schleicher, who both been playing very well recently. So.
And so now, like you just said, moving on to next season, obviously you're a senior, so you won't be able to be a part of any success that may come. But short term, what do you think is next for the season, kind of these next couple tournaments, but also long term, kind of looking forward for the future of Oswego Golf?
Yeah, so this year we got two more tournaments. This weekend we have off, so our next tournament will be Tuesday at Elmira. Go to Elmira, hopefully get a result there. And then obviously our home tournament, we'll finish it out at the last weekend of April. So we'll look to get a W there as well. Going forward, you know, just build the program. Coach has done a pretty good job recruiting kids. So it looks good going forward.
And thank you again for coming on, Laker Connection, Sean. But coming up next, we will be breaking down the Oswego State baseball team and were they able to keep their winning streak and undefeated record at home alive? You'll find out later after the break. You're watching Laker Connections on WTOP 10.
To wear a uniform for service or sacrifice. Every day, ordinary Americans perform extraordinary acts of courage and selfless service. Please join us in recognizing citizen heroes who have made a difference in the lives of others through their acts of courage and selfless service in communities across America. Nominate a citizen hero today at themedalofhonor.com.
Are you thinking about buying medicine online? A search for online pharmacies yields more than 20 million results. But which ones can you trust? Medicines bought from unlicensed online pharmacies can be dangerous. You may get a fake drug, your condition may get worse, or you may experience a bad reaction. Don't put your health at risk. To learn how to find an online pharmacy that's safe and legal, visit fda.gov/besaferx. A message from the U.S. Food and Drug Administration.
Here at WTOP, we pride ourselves on delivering you all the news you need to know from the day's events.
Whether it's happened on Capitol Hill or right here in Oswego, we make sure you know all about it.
We keep you up to date on all your favorite Oswego and professional sports.
And our Storm Team 10 meteorologists will make sure that you know exactly what weather you're up against when you start your day.
Every Monday through Thursday night, make sure to tune in to Channel 10.2, because at WTOP, we don't just tell you the news.
We are
the news.
And we are back here on WTOP 10. It's time to take you through the previous week in Oswego State sports.
Well, Oswego State started off its week with a doubleheader against non-conference Clarkson University. In the first game, the Lakers won 4-1. Nick Chilson went 2-for-3 at the plate with a home run while scoring two runs himself. Kieran Finnegan went the distance, averaging a strikeout per inning while only allowing just 4 hits. And in the second game, Oswego State swept the series with a 10-0 combined no-hitter. Mike Delacari went 3-for-3 with a home run, just falling short of the cycle. He also had 3 RBIs. The Lakers pitching staff saw 4 pitchers hit the mound. Jake Jacobs pitched 3 innings and recorded 5 strikeouts. And Matt Bowman recorded the win after only pitching 1 inning to improve to 3-2 on the season.
And Laker baseball trying to keep pace with Cortland in the Suniac standings, and it was the Oneonta Red Dragons coming to town to take on Coach Lander's squad in conference action. A good first inning was again the recipe for Oswego State. A 4 spot held up until the 5th and 6th innings, where Oneonta mounted a run in each frame to make it 5-2 heading into the latter stages. Nick DeMarco would falter in only those 2 innings as he went 8 strong, allowing just 1 earned run. Ronald Loomis came in to hold down the 5-run lead and struck out 2 and walked 1 to close out game 1 with an Oswego State win. The Lakers outhit the Red Dragons 8-5, led by Brandon Nicholson, who went 2-for-4 and drove in 3.
And Oswego State continued the dominance over SUNY Oneonta, winning both games of the doubleheader to sweep the weekend series. In the closest matchup between both teams in their history, Oswego State won 1-0, and the game was a scoreless heading into the bottom of the 7th. Oneonta's Robert Ottaviano hit the Lakers' first batter of the inning, Miles Felton, and after Ottaviano wild pitch, Felton advanced to second base. Justin Troelstra moved Felton to third base with a sacrifice bunt. And after another wild pitch, Felton scored the game-winning run. Brian Nolan, who improved to 4-1, went the distance and struck out 8 batters. In the second game, the Lakers improved their win streak to over the Red Dragons to 12 games. In the 5-2 victory for Oswego State, Brandon Nicholson went 2-for-3 with a home run and 2 runs scored himself. Jake Terrell earned the win, pitching 5 innings and striking out 3.
Oswego weather starting to cooperate a little more with us, and the baseball team got in 2 games today against Alfred State. In game 1, the Lakers allowed a run in the top half of the first inning, but answered with 3 of their own in the home half. Alfred's defense did not help them in the slightest during game 1, making 7 errors to allow 4 unearned runs to score as the Lakers went on to win 9-4 in game 1, with Jake Jacobs earning his 2nd win of the season over 4.1 innings pitched. Game 2 was more of the same. Alfred made 4 errors, allowing 3 unearned runs to score. Ryan Enos drove in 3 for the Lakers, and Bobby Zawicki went 5 full while only striking out 1, but he surrendered just 4 hits and 2 runs in the 8-2 game 2 win for the Lakers.
And following the 7-5 loss, top of the first inning, Oswego State fell to SUNY Geneseo. Emily Nolden hits it straight back to the pitcher, and she's thrown at first, but Lakers still do get the sacrifice run in from Aaron Sweeney. Top of the 4th, now Lakers still holding on by a score of 3-1. Nolden scoring again at the plate. She singles the center field. Brianna Lamonacono scores from 3rd. Madalana Rubel tries to score from 3rd, but score from 2nd. And now bottom of the same inning, 4-2 Lakers. Taylor Federer singles to left field, and Hannah Elmer scores. Knights only now trailing by 1. Geneseo up to bat again in the bottom of the 5th inning. Elmer is now at the plate this time. She hits it to center field. Danny DiNapoli comes in from 3rd base to score. Ashley Kirsch comes in from 2nd base to score and the game-tying run. Elsa Persich all the way from 1st base scores the eventual game-winning run. Elmer with a double 6-5 in favor of the Knights. And the Knights would tack on 1 more for the 7-5 loss. But following that 7-5 loss, Oswego State did not respond in the 2nd game against SUNY Geneseo. The Lakers were shut out 8-0. It limited to just 2 hits. Rebecca Vilches went the distance, striking out 3 batters and allowing just 4 earned runs.
And staying with softball, the Lakers are deep in the chase for one of the final playoff spots as they travel to Brockport over the weekend. Game 1 went the Lakers' way. It was a slugfest with 22 combined runs, the Lakers scoring 12 of those runs to come out on top. Oswego State scored in 6 of the 7 innings, but in the bottom of the 7th, Brockport scratched across 3 runs to make it a 12-10 game with Brianna Harrington on the rubber. The freshman would work out of it to give the Lakers the win. The day's 2nd game in Brockport was tied at 2 going to the 5th inning, and that's where Brockport did their damage with 5 runs. Cammy Duggan and Maddie Lucas both drove in 2 runs out of the 6 that crossed to make it an 8-2 game. Oswego State was not done, though. In top of the 7th, Rebecca Vilches singled in a run, followed by Angela Frampton double, scoring another. A Brianna Harrington sack fly scored Emily Nolan, but that was all the Lakers could muster. However, And Nolan was the most consistent Laker on the day, scoring four runs and driving in three. The Lakers split with the Golden Eagles after an 8-5 road loss.
And Oswego State won both games of the conference doubleheader against Plattsburgh State today. The Lakers won the first game 9-1, scoring in five of the six innings. Rebecca Vilches pitched five innings, striking out four batters and improved to 4-9 on the season. The Lakers won a much closer second game by a score of 4-2, however. Seven players recorded a hit for Oswego State, and Emily Nolden's hit was a two-run home run in the sixth inning, propelling Oswego State to victory. The Lakers had three pitchers make appearances. Angela Frampton recorded her second win of the season after pitching just one inning. Oswego State is now 10-16 with a 5-5 conference record, and they play again Wednesday against SUNY Potsdam for another conference doubleheader.
Coming up after the break, Aaron Valentino will join us for our weekly Laker Showdown on WTOP 10, so don't go away.
Once there was a boy who did the same thing again and again. One day, he was told he had autism. He got help and slowly learned how to live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
Welcome back to Laker Connections. I'm Aaron Valentino. Ben, you were able to pull out a win last week.
I was.
Congratulations.
You know who wasn't? The Tampa Bay Lightning.
We don't have a lot of time, so let's just get right into it. Emily Nolden is having a solid season so far, batting .423 with a .474 on-base percentage and slugging .606. With that being said, can Emily Nolden make first-team All-SUNYAC? Cole, we'll start with you.
I don't know if he gets to go first.
She was my MVP last week, Nolden was, when we talked about that. But it's still such a tough task to ask that, especially somebody who has just burst on the scene here for Oswego State. She is a senior, but I'm going to go with yes here. You see her stats right there on the screen, but just for reference, looking at what she did compared to Rebecca Vilches last year, who was the player of the year, obviously what she did pitching as well.
That was last year,
you look
but
at,
okay.
Yes, that's what I said, last year. Batting
last
average.
Year.
Last year's stats were bad. See, you're not even going to get your time now here because there's 30 seconds left, but got to cut it short now. Nolden stats compared to Vilches last year. Better batting average.
Cut in when you would like.
See,
more
but here's
home
the
runs.
Thing.
Better slugging average.
Based off the selection committee, they're going to look at Oswego. They're like sixth place in the conference right now. They're going to look at Geneseo, Cortland, and Buff State, and that's how they're going to get their top three. Because she's a catcher. They only have like one catcher spot for the first team, right? So they're going to pick one of those top three. She's not going to make the first team unless she's better than those three catchers, which I highly doubt she is.
Every
I don't care what her stats are.
Time is up. Time is up. That's
categories
it.
Is within the top
she
eight,
is batting
so you know
430. I think that's going to be enough to get her into the first team All-SUNYAC.
No, she's got second
Cole,
team.
You're going to take the point here. Let's move on. This weekend, the Oswego State baseball team will take on SUNYAC leader Cortland in the three-game series. Cortland leads or is near the top in every statistical category. What does Oswego have to do to win this series, Ben?
there's not much they can do. It's Cortland, honestly. Like, okay, so last year they played Cortland at Oswego, lost a series, lost the chance to host a tournament, the SUNYAC tournament, that is. So, you know, it's a bunch of different things. Cortland's just, Oswego State has had good games in SUNYAC, but Cortland has had great games. So, you know, there's not a big run, there's not a big run differential between both teams. They're both around the same, but Cortland is just has so much more experience. It's like, it's not even fair at this point where I think Cortland's got it.
Well, it's only a one game that separates these two teams, so I don't think it's unfair that these two teams
no, it's
are
not
matching
unfair,
up. They're obviously in the same conference, but you look at...
It's at the point where it's just unfair from the standpoint where they just... Cortland's just
unfair,
that much better.
Not a good word, man. Sorry about that. But you can't make mistakes in the field. If you're going to give up errors to this team, like Cortland, you're going to give them free passes. They're going to capitalize on those mistakes. For a team that's as historically as good as Cortland is, you have to make sure the defense behind your pitchers is not letting them down, giving up extra base runners, and prolonging innings.
So does that mean you think they can win?
Ben, you really didn't give him a reason.
I gave a reason.
Win.
It's called Cortland's just that much better.
You just said Cortland's going to win. I'm going to give Cole the point and the win tonight. Ben, this is all for pride, man. You don't want to get swept.
Honestly.
I should have won.
Around! This time of year, the Lakers hockey captains are picked. The captain and first alternate captain are known but have not been publicly released. With that being said, who do you think will be the second alternate captain for the hockey team this year?
Hockey.
Well, I've only heard one, too. I want to clarify that. But there's a couple of guys I think could fit that role. I think David Richie is one. He's been every press conference. But being a goalie, I think that's tough. I like Carter Allen in that spot. He's a defenseman. You need a guy like that. Gosek preaches it all the time. You need to be good in the classroom. You need to be good in the community. Last year, Carter Allen, SUNYAC Commissioner Honor Roll list. He's got a year left of eligibility next year. He has another year to work into maybe a captaincy role like you saw with Josh Zizek this year. He could be the captain this year.
What about Michael Gillespie? Okay, you saw him all year long. You had the stat that Carter Allen's never missed a game. Woohoo. Michael Gillespie has only missed games due to injury. That was this past season. And we know very well there's no way he should have been playing. He's got a fiery and lively attitude. He's going to check you after every whistle. Give that spark.
That's the thing.
He's got previous higher experience too.
For a leader,
but he's a vocal leader.
Josh
Zizek
does
the same exact thing.
But for a leader who needs to talk to referees, Gillespie is not your guy.
Josh Zizek does the same exact thing, though.
No,
you need a senior, not a junior, for your second
alternate. I am going to go with Ben on this one. Michael Gillespie should be the alternate captain.
I'll put $100 on it. He's not wearing it.
Well,
I'll put $100 on Carter Allen.
All right.
I'll crib it. I'll put
$500. That is all the time
we
have for tonight.
But
make sure you tune in next week, same time, same place, for the latest news and highlights in Lakers sports. For Ben Grieco and Cole Parzyk, I'm Aaron Valentino. Have a great night, everybody.
Allen, baby.
Gillespie.
I'm Zachary Haynes. I'm the new host and producer of the new comedy sketch show, Acting Out, a comedy sketch show by college students for college students. You can check us out here on WTOP every other Sunday this semester on B Weekends. Okay, I guess B Weekends are down here now in the bottom left corner of your screen. Anyways, we got all sorts of great sketch. Okay, guys, what's going on with the set? What's going on?
You made her college years possible. Opening